Bossman Show, going to the A-10 with Dave Paulsen, coach of the George Washington Patriots. 9-1 on the year so far. Coach, how things up there in Fairfax, man?
Everything's going great here. Beautiful sunny day, and the sun always looks better after a win, you know. So, like I said, we're off to a good start. We know we got a lot of work yet to do.
Yes, indeed, Coach. You begin year five leading the Patriots, Coach. What do you say been your greatest accomplishment since you've been at George Mason so far?
Well, you know what? We haven't, you know, I wouldn't say we've gotten anywhere yet. You know, to be honest with you, Jay, we're hungry. You know, I think probably the accomplishment is I think we have built a culture now, and it's taken some time in terms of how our guys conduct themselves in the classroom and on campus and how we work. You know, how we work in practice, how we work outside of practice, the unselfishness of our group, and that's what's starting to pay some fruit now. But it's been a challenging run. You know, I think we've done progressively better in the conference every year. So when we got here, they were coming off a 13th out of 14th place finish. We went 12th, 7th, 5th, and 5th. We won the most league games we've ever won at George Mason last year. So, you know, I think it's been a steady improvement, but, you know, we haven't exploded, and we're hoping that we can do that here, you know, real soon.
Now, Coach, you won 18 games last year. I know the guys probably feel good about that. So what did you prioritize with your staff and the team in April, May, June, July, and August to get ready for this season coming up?
Well, you know, we knew we were going to lose a dynamic score. Otis Livingston started every game for 4 years. You know, and was, you know, really dominated our team in a lot of ways. So we had to reinvent ourselves, you know, and become a much more balanced team. I think our guys were excited about that. You know, really share the ball. Different guys stepping forward every night. We've had that. You know, our leading returning scorer, MVP from last year, Justin Kyer, is just coming back after a stress fracture. So he still is on a minutes restriction. But we've had four other guys who were, you know, more unsung last year, who are averaging double figures. So I think that's what we emphasize is sharing the load, really becoming a balanced team, and becoming a better defensive team. And our defensive numbers have been really, really good, and I think that's kind of where we've hung our hat.
Defensively, Coach, is that more of a film session, kind of a teaching tool, or are you more so doing those 4-on-4 shell drills and actually on-ball defending in practice to get those guys commits at the end of the floor, because the defense rebounding travels no matter where you go. Shooting may not, but that travels every night for sure.
No question. And it's just, certainly there's film work involved, teaching the technique and rotations, but there's no substitute for being on the court, one-on-one closeouts, guarding the ball, shell drill, guarding ball screens, post defense, and just, you know, grinding it. And you know, I think that's a group. There's a group that's worked really hard in the weight room. You know, it's in the best condition of any team I've had this year at George Mason. So all that has translated. We've played our best defense, and we've played our best in the second half of every game. You know, so I'm just looking at our season stats. In the first half of games, we're being outscored 300 to 295, but second half, we're outscoring opponents by 55 points, you know, overall over 10 games. So, you know, I think our conditioning has helped wear teams down.
Now, Coach, talk about that, because I talk to people all the time, Coach. Having a great strength and conditioning program, a great strength coach, is very key to any program, because we say in the second half or in the dog days of January and February and into March, you need to be conditioned and have the energy to defend and make those key plays in clutch situations in them tough games that come up that time of year.
Well, we think we have the best in the business. A guy named Handy Hanrahan has been here for quite a long time. And, you know, when Coach Larinaga, you know, was the architect of the Mason's run to the Final Four, when he went to Miami, he tried to bring Handy with him. But Handy and his wife and family are entrenched in the Northern Virginia community. So he didn't leave, and that was our benefit. He works the guys hard, but he's got a great chemistry with them. The guys love him. You know, he's like another assistant coach on our staff, you know, reinforcing our culture, our habits, our work ethic. And he's been really, really pivotal to our early season success.
Now, Coach, also, I feel like with your success, Coach, I feel like, you know, you can recruit at every way you want to. It'd be a high school senior, prep school kid, JUCO, got the right fit, transfer, grand transfer, or international kid, because the success you've had, the culture you've established at George Mason, and what you're the winning you guys doing, being playing the A-10, which is a great basketball conference as well, to get guys who want to come up and play for you guys.
Yeah, we think we, you know, we've got, number one, it's a world-class university. It's the largest university in the state of Virginia. Our graduates have the highest average salaries of any school in Virginia. People don't know that, you know. So guys come out of George Mason making more money than from University of Virginia, Virginia Tech, or, you know, William & Mary, some of the old established schools. It's a cutting-edge degree, number one. So, you know, it's an international school, so we can recruit internationally. But the biggest thing we've tried to do is we've really lived with high school players, with guys who maybe a little bit under the radar, a little under recruited, got a chip on their shoulder. But, you know, we like the long, lean, lanky guys who maybe when they get in our strength program can really blossom with their juniors and seniors. And that's what you're starting to see. We've got a redshirt junior now, A.J. Wilson. He's close to leading the country in blocks. He's got 40 blocks in 10 games. You know, he's averaging 9.5 rebounds a game, 12 points per game. He was a guy who needed the red shirt, needed to get stronger. But he's as athletic a front court player as you're going to find anywhere.
You got that right, Coach. And I'm looking at, like you said, also, Coach, look at this. I feel like you guys are very much closer to D.C. It helps lots because guys like to live in kind of a bigger city to a degree. So the D.C. allure with being so close to you guys helps get guys from DMV and Northeastern or from a bigger city to come play for you as well.
No question. You know, I think we have the best of both worlds. We've got a beautiful, suburban, modern campus. Our guys love it. Great dorms, great campus life. But in 25 minutes, we're going to be downtown D.C. seeing a Wizards game, seeing a Nationals game, obviously Nationals fever. Here in the DMV, with them winning the World Series, you know, getting to the Smithsonian, getting to the Capitol, getting to some of the cultural events. So, you know, we feel like we got the best of both worlds.
You got that right, Coach. And I know you guys had a tough game against Jacksonville State last night, and Ray Harper always is a tough guy to coach against. So how was the game last night against Jacksonville State, and what was the key to winning that game last night, Coach?
Well, you know, again, you're right. Ray Harper's as good a coach as there is in the business. You know, they played, I think they've been on the road. Yeah, Bray would probably take been on the road for a month, you know. So, but they've got a talented team that's going to find its legs. We came back, we played 5 games in 8 days. We won the Cayman Islands Classic Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday of last week. Played great basketball, beat Old Dominion, beat Nebraska, beat New Mexico State in the championship. We were a little sluggish, to be honest with you, JR. We kind of looked like we were stuck in the mud. But I told our guys afterwards, in 26 years of coaching, a lot of the teams I've coached who've been in that scenario have lost that game because they couldn't get out of the mud. And you know, we found it within ourselves to get to the foul line, to get in the offensive glass, to come up with some steals in our three-quarter court pressure, and just have enough energy plays, you know, to kind of win the day. It wasn't a masterpiece by any chance, but I told our guys, Picasso didn't paint all masterpieces. So sometimes you just got to slug it out and hopefully get away with a win.
And like you said, bringing the right attitude, the right energy, the right effort, you can will your way to a win because that's what counts when March comes around. Because you might not have the shooting touch that night. You might not be, like, this might go, you know, it might go your way, a call might not go your way. But if you bring that energy, effort, and the right attitude, you can still get the job done for sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Now, Coach, you got American this weekend. So, Coach, that's on the 7th here. So what are you seeing for those guys on film as you get ready to prepare for those guys?
Well, I'm just sitting down to start watching film on American. Very, very good team. Very well-coached team, Mike Brennan. They run the Princeton system. Last year, they got it. And it was, you know, we're still singing for that loss. So, you know, hopefully our guys will be motivated, focused. They've got a very good point guard, Saeed Nelson, you know, a lot of balance. We're going to have to really defend for the entire game, but we're also going to have to defend for the entire shot clock. You know, so it's a very deliberate team, and we're going to have great defensive discipline.
Now, Coach, it's kind of a unique quirk in your schedule here that after American, you have 2 weeks off of no games. So it's an opportunity for you to kind of do some self-scouting and more skill development, which you're trying to get them prepared for the tough slate of the A-10 coming up there real quickly.
Yeah, we played a ton of games, you know. So we played 10 games already, you know. In first game was November 5th and last game was December 3rd. So in under a month, we played 10 games. And then we'll go, like you said, with 2 weeks without a game. We're in final exams. We'll give our guys a couple days off. We had this break last year, and we called it a mini boot camp. And our guys maybe aren't that excited about it, but this is when we can kind of get back to work. You know, we haven't had more than 2 days at a time of practice without a game. You know, so you're always game prepping or game reviewing. And so we'll get a chance to kind of look back in the lab and get down to some of the fundamentals, some of the skill development, and maybe, you know, tweak some things in our defensive and offensive package.
Now, Coach, look at the A-10 right now, Coach. 11 of the 14 teams are .500 or better non-conference play. It has to make you happy as a being a member of the A-10, but also, like, man, it's going to be a gauntlet come January for sure.
Yeah, you know what? It's like a mixed bag because, you know, we do. We all root for each other, you know, non-conference because, you know, a rising tide lifts all boats. And our ability to get multiple teams into the postseason, NCAA tournament, NIT, get good seeds really hinges not only on, you know, how each individual team does, but the success of the league. And so our league, I thought going into the season it would be the best that it's been in my 5 years. I think that's being proven to be true. You know, and so that's a good thing. But come January and February, boy, it's going to be a bloodbath. And I'm not so sure I'm looking forward to that. But, you know, it's a really good league, and the coaches are all tremendous coaches, but really good colleagues as well. So there's a really healthy blend of competitiveness and then also good spirit.
And, Coach, you have a young man on your roster from Javon Green, which is about 10 miles from my house in McDonough, Georgia. So we're both Henry County residents. So talk to us a lot about Javon Green, what he means to your program.
Well, Javon is a junior now. He was our sixth man as a freshman. He started last year. He's elevated his game. He's at 13.4 points per game right now. He's 7.2 rebounds per game. He leads our team in steals. He leads our team in assists. He also leads our team in turnovers. Okay, so we're going to have to talk to him about that. But he's a guy who can do a little bit of everything. He shoots the ball well from three, can take it to the rim. He's our best perimeter defender. You know, he's elevated his game. And now the next step for him, I was kind of joking about the turnovers, but, you know, he's always good for one or two kind of bad turnovers a game. If we could take that out of his game and add one more smart play, then I think he got a first-team all-conference caliber guard. And that's what we want him to progress to become.
And I feel like a guy like him being come from the Atlanta area, McDonough, Georgia, because like you said, a guy from the suburbs, but also a bigger city as well. And, hey, we're playing for you in Fairfax and George Mason, it's like what he's used to already because of where he lives at in Atlanta. So I feel it's a great fit for your program as well.
Yeah, he is a great fit. And most importantly, he's of the highest character. He's a great young man. And like I said, he was kind of a guy who was a little bit under the radar. You know, kind of long, wiry, but not filled out. He's starting to fill out. And so I think his best basketball is still definitely ahead of him.
That's what I got for you, Coach. Look at your roster, Coach. A lot of international guys on your roster. So what's the importance for you for recruiting internationally, having guys from different backgrounds on your roster for sure to blend together as one?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, we just want guys who, you know, fit with our culture. You know, they can be from 10 minutes from campus. We've got some, you know, our leading scorer, Jordan Miller, is, you know, half hour away from campus. Our second leading scorer, like you said, is Javon Green from the Atlanta area. We got a guy from Canada. We'll continue recruiting internationally. But the most important thing is that they're good kids and they fit in and they buy into our culture of trying to just really work every day and prove it as a player.
Well, Coach Paulsen, thank you for your time today. Have a Merry Christmas. I look forward to talking to you in the new year for sure.
All right, thanks, Jeff.
All right, folks, Dave Paulsen here on the Bossman Show from George Mason.
My heart skips skipping the beat. You're not close enough, so that space between you and me, let's lose it. The way you're dancing, swaying to the music. Girl, that body and how you move it. Every time you cross my mind, girl, I lose it.
Alexa, play the Country Heat playlist.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
It's maybe the night that my dreams might let me know. All the stars are closer. All the stars are closer.
Tell me what you gonna do to me. Confrontation ain't nothing new to me. You could bring a bullet, bring a sword, bring a morgue, but you can't bring the truth to me.
Alexa, play Kendrick Lamar and SZA.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Till the tears run down from my eyes, Lord, somebody, ooh, somebody, can anybody find me somebody to love?
Alexa, play hits from Queen.
Okay.
With Amazon Music, a voice is all you need. Get tens of millions of songs. Download the Amazon Music app today.
Folks, you enjoyed the Bossman Show with Danny Kaspar, the Texas State Bobcats out of the Sun Belt Conference. Coaches in Houston tonight, ready to play with the Houston Cougars. Coach was Kelvin Sampson. Coach, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good, JR. How are you doing?
Coach, I can't complain, man. The holiday season is here. It's sunny here in Atlanta, and life's great, man.
Yes, we got a beautiful day here in Houston also. So, and hopefully we'll have a nice night after tonight.
You got there right, Coach. Hey, Coach, you're in year 7 leading the Bobcats here. So tell me, Coach, what do you find has been your greatest accomplishment in your time leading the Bobcats so far?
Now, would you repeat that, please, one more time?
Yes. What was your greatest accomplishments leading the Bobcats so far? You've been there 7 years.
We've got this program we think turned around to where they had 12 straight years of losing seasons, and then our first 2 years we had losing seasons, but now we've had 20 win seasons two out of the last 3 years. We feel like we've got it where we want it, we feel like we're in a good place right now at 6-2, with the win over Las Vegas, with losses to Baylor and Air Force on the road, and. We feel like we've got this thing turned around. We're going in a positive direction. Our kids are graduating. Our APR was about perfect score last year. And, we think we just got the kind of people you need to have in your program if you want to win.
You got there right, Coach. You had 24 wins last year. So in April, May, June, July, and August, Coach, what did you guys prioritize to be even better this year? You had 24 wins last year.
Well, again, my thing, I'm a big believer in that your offense is a very fickle thing. I was a Division I player myself, and it was because I had the reputation of being a shooter, yet there were some nights where I could not explain why I was only 5-for-14, whereas three nights earlier I was 9 or 10-for-14. And through my own experience, I've come to believe that, yes, you work on offense, but if your defense is clicking and you're off and you're not shooting the ball well, you still can win the game. If your defense is clicking and you're shooting the ball well, you're probably going to win the game in a blowout. And that's been description of my philosophy. That's what I'm about. We're going to defend. We're going to take good shots. We're going to defend, and we're going to have a chance to win every night because we do so.
And Coach, defensively, teaching that skill for players, is it more of a film session or is it more of a on-court shell drill, one-on-one ball, on-ball defending?
It's more on-court, but we do use film to help because there's nothing like showing someone what they look like on film. They take a great interest in watching themselves. And sometimes they don't believe what you're saying, so you got to use the film room to prove what you're saying is correct. However, most of it is on the court, generally speaking, recruits take a year to buy in, but after that, they help you sell the product. And so I tell the players that I can play you a lot if you play great defense. even if you're not a great, even if you're not shooting the ball well, or even if you're not a great scorer, I can play you enough that you can be happy. But you got to be. But I can't play you a lot if you're not shooting the ball well, but you're a poor defender.
You get out there, right, Coach? And I kids don't understand this, Coach. Like you tell them, defense rebounds travel. Like you said, the shot may not, but energy, effort, defensive rebounding can always travel anywhere, any place in the country.
Correct. I'm 100% agreement with that.
Yes, indeed. And the coach also, and if they can get that optimum defensive prowess, I feel like the strength coach is very key to your program as well, getting those guys in shape, conditioned properly to be able to defend the second half of games and not be tired. So talk about your strength coach and what he means to your program.
You're talking about, say that again, please?
Yeah, I was talking about your coach, conditioning coach, who really helps get your guys in shape for you to be able to defend hard for you guys. So what does he mean to your program?
Oh, yeah. You're talking about our strength coaches?
Like, yes, sir.
What you're asking?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Strength programs are very important. You got to be able to, first of all, play hard. You got to be strong and in shape to play hard. I think the difference between successful programs and programs that are just somewhat successful is that, you know, play hard. Play hard the whole time you're in there. You want your team playing hard for 40 minutes and not taking breaks in the game. And that's where a strength and conditioning coach can really, really help you in terms of getting them strong, getting them to believe in themselves as they see their body develops. They take pride in that. And, of course, you know, getting in great shape so you can exert defensive pressure and offensive pressure. So you're really pushing the ball down the floor after a miss or a turnover, and then you're getting back and you're really – now you're getting in the passing lanes, you're pressuring the basketball, and like you said earlier, then you don't – you block out and you just dominate the boards, giving up only one shot or less if you make them turn it over per possession for the game. And that's kind of like I just believe effort, just like in life, effort and teamwork and communication can really, really take you very far.
Yes, indeed. And Coach, like tonight, you play a Houston team, a great coach team by Kelvin Sampson. So what are you seeing from those guys on film as you prepare to play them tonight and get your team ready to go tonight at the Fatigue Center over there, on their campus over there?
Yeah, it's first of all, Coach Sampson's teams always have played hard. They're very good rebounders, very physical. So we're expecting a tough, tough physical ball game tonight. They execute well on offense and they're very aggressive on defense. And, so, you know, we're expecting, I told my players, you know, it's not a game for, people that don't like to be, bumped around. I mean, you're going to have to get in there and compete. And they have a tremendous record at home. BYU got them this year on a last second shot. There's an unbelievable shot that beat them, but they've been pretty tough the last couple, 2-3 years here at the Fertitta Center. And so we're expecting a tough ball game, but we went to Baylor and played a very good Baylor team very close earlier this year and went to Vegas and beat Vegas. And so we're, you know, we feel like those games have given us some preparation for this one.
Of course, I feel like your team is very tough-minded and very – grizzled bunch, because I saw you guys go on the road and get the play the Baylor way you did and beating Vegas, which is a team so do some in the Mountain West out there. So, like you said, Coach, I feel like you have a great shot tonight as well. And you got three guys on your roster from Houston. So, how excited are those guys to be able to play in their hometown in front of their family and friends tonight against the Cougars?
Yeah. Well, we have three guys from Houston. We have one from Beaumont, which is 80 miles away. We've got some players with families, with relatives in Houston. So Houston's always been a prime recruiting territory for us. We have a lot of alumni living here, a lot of friends and family living here, my wife's family. They're all living in Houston. So, you know, we feel like there'll be some Bobcat fans in the crowd tonight. But it's you know, this is a game that I said this earlier to another media outlet. I told him, I said, you know, I don't like getting on planes anymore. I don't like fighting those security lines. And secondly, we're going to play Houston tonight. We'll probably leave somewhere around 9:45 from the arena, and we could be home by 12:30. And if you're going to fly somewhere to play, you can't get out. You got to spend the night. You got to get up early in the morning and not get home, not get back till 2. We don't miss class. We miss very little class by playing games like this. We play in front of family and friends. We play in areas that we recruit, and we're home quicker. So to me, it's a no-brainer. You know, we want to play people like Houston, Texas, Texas A&M, you know, Texas Tech, TCU, SMU, all those schools, Baylor, if we can, where they're basically a bus trip.
Exactly, Coach. And, you know, at your level, you have to kind of raise money for universities. It also helps for expenses. We have to raise money playing those bye games as well, for sure.
Yes, we have to do that. We play two bye games a year. And I like to not only use them to make money, but also use these tough games on the road to season us, so to speak, for the conference play that's be coming up here in about 3-4 weeks.
You got that right, Coach. And Texas has so many great D1 schools and many different conferences, so you use a lot of guys you can play. And say, Texas is not even lead, like you said, you don't get on plans anymore. It's right perfect for you. And they say, Texas, all the great schools you can play a drive away.
Well, correct. You know, like I told the guys, I said, now the only thing that, you know, we are playing in front of family and friends, we're playing in front of home, so you better come to play, because, you know, getting your butt beat in front of your family and friends is not very very nice.
You got there right. Yeah, because they will give it to you the hardest, for sure, if you do get your butt beat.
You better be ready to play. If we're going to do this, guys, you got to be ready to play, man. So, you know, you go play somewhere like Duke and get beat, and, you know, even though, you know, they got beat by one of another Texas school, but you go to a place like Duke or North Carolina, and there's nobody, you know, we may have 10 people at the game here, but like tonight, we may have 100, 150 people ask for tickets.
Now, Coach, you have a little break after San Antonio. You play those guys. So it's awesome if you kind of do some self-scouting a little bit, some evaluating over your players, and kind of do some skill development with those guys, get them prepared for that tough, tough Sun Belt play coming up in January there.
Well, we've been playing. We haven't had a day off pretty much one day off a week. So we play UTSA Saturday, UT San Antonio. I'll give these guys, with that, the next week is final week, I'll give these guys off Sunday. We may lift weights Monday, and that's it. But no basketball for 2 days. And then we'll practice, and it won't be a long practice, on Tuesday. And we'll go Tuesday and Wednesday. I'll give them another day off on Thursday, and then we'll practice Friday, Saturday. This will be the first time in, God knows, almost 2 months where we're going to have some time off, and I think it's a good time to give them some days off with finals and things like that. Just get their bodies back and rested and pay attention to the academics.
And, Coach, that's what I got for this, Coach. Look at the Sun Belt Conference, Coach. 10 of the 12 schools are 500 or better at this point, non-conference play. So I know you're sure for those guys doing the non-conference, but when it gets time to January, you're going to want to beat their brains in. But what's that about your conference? 10 of your 12 schools in a mid-major conference like the Sun Belt are 500 or better already at December the 4th here.
Well, we really feel like it's a very good mid-major league. You say it right. Yeah, it's we beat each other up during the year, during conference play, and then it doesn't look as good. And you know, but it's a lot of good teams in this league, and the travel is tough. I mean, that's one of the things. Winning on the road, you got to do it, but travel is tough in this league. And even though we are a mid-major league, most of the time we're not doing charter jets. We're doing commercials. So it's tough on the players, it's tough on the coaches, and it's a grind. But it's part of who we are, and that's what we do. And I think we have some great coaches in our league and some great players in our league. And it's a matter of staying healthy and playing to your strengths and not your weaknesses.
Well, Coach Kaspar, best luck to you tonight, and have a Merry Christmas. I'll talk to you again in January, February, coaches, and keep an eye on your team, man. Thank you for doing this today. I really appreciate it. On a game day for me.
Appreciate it. Thank you for giving me the time. You have a nice day.
You too, Coach. That's Danny Kaspar on the Bossman Show.
Hello, my name is Travis Williams, President and CEO of Academics and Athletic Consulting, focusing on educating and empowering tomorrow's collegiate athletic leaders. My passion is for the education and genuine concern and care for today's student athlete. It's the centerpiece of my life's work. A college education, both in and out of the classroom, is a truly rewarding benefit. For more information on AAC, you can go to www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. www.academicsandathletics.com. Once again, www.academicsandathleticsconsulting.com. Or you can follow me on Facebook at Academics and Athletic Consulting, or Twitter at Coach TWill24, or Instagram Travis L. Williams 24. Or you can call me at 404-542-6079. Once again, AAC is very proud to partner with J.R. McHenry of the Bossman Radio Show, covering sports and entertainment across the country. Please tune in weekly for informative, entertaining, and expert analysis on today's sports and entertainment topics. Thank you.
All right, folks, we're on the Bossman Show. We're here with Pat Baldwin of Milwaukee Panthers out of the Horizon League. Coach, how you doing today, man?
Doing well. I wish I could be doing better with the win, but we got to just keep on moving on.
Coach, you know you're in year three now leading the Panthers, man. I can't believe it's been 3 years since we started having you on the show here. But tell us, Coach, what's been your greatest accomplishment in your mind since taking over this Panther program in 2017 here?
Well, I think the old adage says is, you're just trying to work and build your culture, and that's been the greatest accomplishment for me and our staff and our program is, we're finally getting to the point where we have some kids that are bought into what we're trying to do and what we're trying to build, and we're close. We're close. We've had some really good games where we've won, some games that are extremely close that could have gone either way, and we've lost those. So, there's some things we need to do in order to turn the corner, and I think we're close to making those things happen. But my greatest accomplishment, though, beyond that, is just seeing our guys graduate, making sure that they're mentally strong and mentally healthy, and just to be able to continue to do this, because it's tough. As a student athlete, I've been through it before. There's so many pressures on you, from doing well in school to having a coach make sure that you're trying to get everything and do everything right on the basketball floor, and then you're just trying to manage life at the same time. So I'm just grateful and thankful for the type of kids that we have.
And, Coach, I feel like for you guys as coaches, you get these guys at 18 and 22 years old. You're the left line defense before they hit the real world, Coach. So just talk about how kids bowl these young men, get them a great education, because everybody's going to go pro in basketball. You're going to hang on those shoes eventually. So you have to be a good husband, a great father, a great lawyer, businessman, and a great citizen of this country after playing ball, and you can go into the real world here.
Yeah, no question about it. And we talk about life with our guys all the time. And, I had a conversation with one of our young men the other day from the standpoint of the responsibilities that we have as for them young men and for us as men is, to be accountable and making sure we're doing the right things, not only for ourselves, but for our teams, our family. That's really important. And we preach the life skills almost every single day. And, basketball is a metaphor for life, and our guys understand that. I think they get the message when we talk to them. We just have to continue to remind them each and every day of what is the most important thing. There's no question that we all want to win. There's no question that we all want to compete and strive to do really good things, even after college and play beyond college. But sometimes that really hits you. And, we have to do our job as coaches to make sure that they're prepared for not only just basketball, but for life in general, whether they become, like you said, the fathers or have a job and, have to save money. There's a lot of different things that we do to try to help them grow beyond just basketball.
And, Coach, I know last year was tough for you, Coach, but this offseason, what did you guys prioritize to get better on the court and off the court as a program as a whole? Because I know, like you said, it was tough last year, man. I know it's not what you guys wanted, but I know this April, May, June, July, and August, y'all put in the major work to get better to have you at 5-4 now at December the 4th going into the conference play here real soon.
Yeah, last year was tough. We kind of – you hate to say you expect it, but we had four key guys sitting out last year. And when you do that, you kind of mess with your depth and ability to, be at full strength all the time. So that was something that we really had to work through and endure. This off season, what we really tried to, touch upon was just the toughness and team chemistry. you know, those, and we didn't even talk about winning. We talked about the process to get to that point where in the weight room we had to get, you know, we had to get stronger, we had to get faster, had to get better from that standpoint. On the basketball court, we had to improve. But even off the court, we talked about our family and our team chemistry and how important that is, you know, to winning. You know, you can have the best team in the world, you know, high caliber talent, but if you don't have the chemistry and your guys don't like and respect each other, it's going to be hard to win. You can win some games, but at the same time, when you're in crunch time and in those games that are close, you know, that chemistry stands tall and all that. So that's what we worked on.
Now, Coach, for our listeners out here, you made a key point, Coach, about the strength coach and conditioning getting bigger, stronger, and faster. Talk about how important having a good strength conditioning program and a good strength coach is to a program and getting guys to defend every night, have energy and effort when it comes to second half of games, come February and then into March, where they can have energy that still play at a high level and not be tired and worn down or be outmanned by a team by not being strong enough or fast enough to get the job done.
Yeah. You know, I'll be the first one to say that we have a really good strength and conditioning coach where he preaches everything, not only just inside that weight room and what it means to even compete in there and win each and every day in there. He talks about the things that our guys need outside of the weight room from, you know, like you talked about, the conditioning side of it, the nutrition, making sure our guys are eating right. I think he brings a kind of a, you know, scientific approach to our bodies and the way that, you know, we eat food and what that food means for our bodies, the hydration that is extremely important. And then beyond all of that is the rest and the sleep that you need to get in order for your bodies to recover. You know, we're asking 18 to 22 or 23 year old men to and young men, you know, to work extremely hard, compete, fight for every single inch, whether it's on the floor, in the weight room, and their bodies break down. And, you know, the sleep portion of that is a way to help our guys recover. You know, so if our guys aren't doing that, you know, they're not going to be able to compete at the optimum level. So our strength conditioning coach is really good with all of that stuff. We're on the same page all of the time. He's excellent with that. And we meet regularly to talk about our guys, their bodies, and their schedule.
Now, Coach, outside of the Horizon League games you got coming up here, you got some a schedule that's pretty good, high majors as well, quality mid-majors as well. So what do you, when you play these games, are you trying to play them to get guys back home or to test your team a little bit for Horizon League play? And it's kind of it's a recruiting tool to get your new eyeballs to see what Milwaukee's all about as well.
Yeah, you know, when we look at our schedule, you know, first I have to look at our team and what we have coming in and, you know, obviously, when you schedule, you want to schedule games that you believe that you can win. At the mid-major level and lower, you have to, you know, sometimes your programs require you to get, you know, certain games like at Wisconsin that we have on our schedule in Kansas, you know, some of those bye games in order to help fund your department and your program. You know, so we have to do those games. But then outside of that, when we're playing, you know, Western Michigan and, you know, in the tournament we were in the Bahamas that had, you know, George Washington and Rice, whom we played, and Morgan State, you know, those are really good games that I feel like we could compete in those games and hopefully you win those games and those share of them. And, you know, last night was no different. We lost by 3 to Drake on a last second shot and we felt like we played well enough to win those games. So that goes a lot into our scheduling. And, you know, when we look at it as well, we want to compete at a high level because when we get in our league, there's some really good teams in our league, very well coached. And, you know, we want to prepare ourselves for when we're in those battles in league play. And hopefully, you know, with good play, we can be in position, you know, to be playing in games that are meaningful.
Now, how was the experience in the Bahamas, Coach? I know that the guys love to go over to that tournament over there. So how was the experience for the guys being away from home, being out of the cold weather, been up in Milwaukee for a little while, and get to be together as one in the Bahamas in a good tropical paradise there?
Yeah, I think anytime you do trips like that, it's great for team bonding and chemistry and camaraderie. And, you know, what I told our guys, you know, to enjoy and embrace trips like this, there's, you know, you're never guaranteed opportunities after, you know, after something like this. So, you know, we have a very mature group from the standpoint of, you know, when they were in between the lines, we were in the meeting room and doing stuff, preparing for games. They were really locked in and did a great job of focusing. And I told them after all of that, after being on the court or practice or in the film session, you know, enjoy, go to the beach, put their, you know, toes in the sand, in the water, and just, you know, embrace being in, you know, a different environment. So I thought that was great for our guys. We were in each and every game that we played in the Bahamas, but it was a great opportunity for our guys.
Coach, you got Kansas next week. You know, that's always going to be a tough task, go to Fog Allen Fieldhouse out there in Lawrence, Kansas. So what are you seeing for those guys on the film? How excited are your guys to get to play Kansas, a story team like that, at their place?
Well, you know, I think it goes without saying that anytime you play a team like Kansas, or, you know, you look at what, you know, Evansville going into Kentucky, you know, what they were able to do, you want to put yourself in position to, you know, to try and win those games. And, you know, anything can happen, as we've witnessed in the, you know, in the tournament, or seen in the tournament with UMBC beating Virginia a couple of years ago. So, you know, the first thing you do is you just got to prepare, and prepare the right way. You know, try to take away the strengths that, you know, a program like Kansas has, which, you know, has a great inside-outside combo of Azubuike and Devin Dotson, whom, you know, I'm familiar with. But it's going to be a great environment for our guys. And another test, you know, when you're on the road, you know, I want to see how our guys, you know, respond to a game like that, where, you know, you're going to have 15 to 16,000 plus against you. And, you know, in a raucous environment, in a very steam program like Kansas, I want to see how our guys respond. You know, do we have that toughness to, you know, play in an environment like that and not be afraid of any type of moment? And games like that, you know, I foresee, and I kind of fast forward when we get into our league, you know, preparing us for games in our league when they're, like I said, when they're meaningful. And hopefully we're, you know, battling for a championship.
Coach, speaking of your league, man, I looked at the standings, man. You 6-6 of your 10 teams are 500 or better on December 4th in non-conference play. And that's for a mid-major league. To me, that's a heck of an accomplishment for a mid-major league, having to play, like you said, bye games, or having to play tough opponents on the road. Can't get guys to come play you at your place. So to be 500 or better, 6-6 teams in the league, I'm telling you, that's pretty good in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, our league is really tough. Have very good coaches, very good players in our league, and top to bottom, there's no nights off. And, you know, you look at our schedule, whom we played, you know, and our losses. We lost to a very good Western Michigan team in three overtimes. We, you know, lost to a Conference USA team by six. And then our next two losses are, you know, an average of 3 points in those two losses against GW, George Washington, and Drake. So, you know, I think our league is faring pretty well. I think we can do even better. I think you ask any coach in our league, if, you know, if you give them some games back, would they do some things differently to help you win? And, you know, that margin of victory and losses are very slim. So there's, like I said, there's not going to be any easy games, whether you're at home or on the road, with any of our games in the Horizon League. And, you know, we just have to prepare as best we can and give ourselves a chance to win those games.
Coach Baldwin, good to have you back on the show, man. I'm happy for your success this season. I'll talk to you again in the new year here and check in with you guys, see what you're doing in that Horizon League play there as well.
I appreciate you having us on, and call anytime, and hopefully if you check back in with us, you know, we're in the win column and doing fairly well.
Yes, indeed. I definitely will, Coach. Have a Merry Christmas, Coach, and Happy New Year as well to you and your family, man.
Okay, thank you. You too.
All right.
Take care.
It's Pat Baldwin on the Bossman Show. Thank you, Coach Ken.
Flame-seared, Greek-seasoned Euro meat. This is the kind of meat that only a legit Euro place would get. But maybe you don't think about Arby's as a Euro place. Well, Arby's sells more Greek beef and turkey Euros than anyone else in the country. So, you know what? We're totally a Euro place. We're the Euro place. 2 for $6. Arby's, we have the meat.
At participating Arby's for a limited time.
Did you hear the news? Metro PCS is now Metro by T-Mobile. Now you get new plans with unlimited high-speed data all month long. All on the T-Mobile network. Check out the new Metro by T-Mobile today and discover the smarter way to get unlimited. Metro by T-Mobile. That's genius.
During congestion, the fraction of customers using greater than 35 gigs per month may notice reduced speeds, and Metro customers may notice reduced speeds versus some T-Mobile customers. Video streams at 480p. Coverage not available in some areas. See store for details and terms and conditions.
The Starlight Lounge presents An Evening with the Progressive Box.
Oh, what a great audience. Let's dim the lights for this next one. Nope, too much. Ah, there it is. Got to get things just right. Like Progressive's Name Your Price tool. Tell us what you want to pay, and we help you find coverage options that fit your budget. And now, the mood is right. Wait, the lights are back on again. Trudy, can you? And now it's completely dark.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Price and coverage match limited by state law.
All right, back in the jail, the Bossman Show. We're here with Bob Richey of the Furman Paladins out of the SoCon. Coach, how are things going with you guys as you head to Auburn today?
Doing good. On the bus right now, heading to Auburn. And we've been in Gainesville the last day and a half or so. And left South Florida and headed to Gainesville and practiced there today and yesterday. And heading up to Auburn now.
All right. Well, Coach, you know, you're in year three, being the head man here at Furman, Coach. For you, what's been your biggest accomplishment in your mind being here, your year three, leading this program here that's been so good over the years?
You know, it's just been fun to continue to build it. And, you know, as obviously each year we've tried to progress a little bit more. And, you know, we've been able to accomplish a lot in the last 5 years as a program, coming from, you know, 340 in the RPI 5 years ago to where we are now. And, you know, I've really been able to check off a lot of boxes except that last one of just, you know, getting this program into the NCAA tournament. And so we're working every day to try to get this group as good as it can be. And, you know, trying to get better each day so we can be our best at the end of the year and have a chance to be able to do that.
As you said, Coach, getting better every day. So what did you guys prioritize specifically this offseason, come off 25 wins this season last year in April, May, June, July, and August to prepare for this year and to be at optimal levels to compete in those 3 days in the SoCon tournament there?
Yeah, you know, we lost two seniors last year who happened to be the all-time winningest players in Furman history with, you know, 91 wins in their 4 years, and Matt Rafferty and Andrew Brown. So we knew we had a lot of things that we had to address in the offseason to continue to push the program forward, losing those two players. And so we spent a ton of time, you know, weight room, really trying to get bodies better and really trying to continue to increase our skill and, you know, develop our depth. And that's one of the reasons we've been able to get off to a 7-2 start, because we've had some guys that were in less role last year or really in no role last year, and they've been able to be, you know, key players for us. And, you know, Mike Bothwell was a freshman last year and, you know, didn't play a ton for us. He's our fourth leading scorer right now. And Jalen Slauson's another guy that didn't play a lot for us last year, and he's starting for us at the five right now. So, you know, we've had some guys step up, and then guys that did play last year, they've been able to extend their role. And Clay Mounts just had an incredible offseason, put on 18 pounds of muscle and really continued to develop his game. He was SoCon Player of the Week this week after, you know, averaging 16 and 10 the last three games. So, you know, just saw a lot of improvement in different guys. And fortunately, that's what we've been able to do the last few years, and, you know, to continue to try to be as best as we can.
And, Coach, speak to that a little bit more, Coach. I feel like our fans don't understand this as the way you and I understand it. That skill development and also weight and development with strength coach is very key to a program's success, especially at the SoCon level in mid-major basketball, because you gotta get guys and kind of project them forward as they fill out their bodies, as they grow as young men, to get better as players. So the skill development program on the court and off the court in the weight room with the strength coaches is so key to a program like Furman's and others just similar to you in SoCon as well.
Yeah, I think it's one of the biggest keys at this level. I mean, recruiting is obviously very important, but you know, what you do with the player when you get them, there's just a lot of changes that can be made. And, you know, we're proudly admit that we're a developmental program. We don't hide behind it. We love it. That's kind of our identity. And, you know, three of our top six redshirted. And so that's been something that we really harped on hard in our program, is our players have to be willing to work while they wait. And a lot of times you see in sports, you know, guys just want to start working when they get their opportunity. But for us, We've got to make sure that right when we get them, we put them to work, and they understand work ethic. We identify that in the recruiting process, and they understand that this is going to be a process, and it's not just, hey, we're going to do it 4 months a year. This is a 365 process. This is every single day that we've got to be deliberate in our improvement, and we got to do it daily. And, you know, fortunately, our staff's done a great job of identifying players that want to be a part of that, that aren't just in it for instant gratification. And, you know, last year we won 25 games, and four of the five starters had one Division I offer, and that was Furman. And, you know, so it's something that's been a huge part of our success, is to find people that want to be developed, because not everybody wants to be developed. A lot of people just want to play and really embrace that development, and then understanding that when your time comes, you're going to be ready. And, you know, we got two guys redshirt right now, and they're going to be really, really good. Nobody knows about them right now because they're redshirting. But I'm telling you, in a couple of years, Marcus Foster and Johnny Lawrence are going to be big pieces of our program. And right now, all they're doing every single day is lifting, skill development, eating, training, learning our system, and making the best they can on scout team. And that's a huge part of our program.
Yes, indeed. And, Coach, looking outside of your SoCon games, you've played some high majors as well, some quality mid-majors matchups as well. So let's talk about the scheduling piece of the equation and how that's so important for your program, not to get better for this year, but also as a recruiting tool to get yourself in front of new eyeballs or get your players close to home and play in front of their family and friends as well.
Yeah, you know, we like to challenge ourselves in the non-conference. And, you know, as you win, it gets harder to get games. But, you know, we want to go on the road. I think six of our first nine have been on the road. And, you know, we want to make sure that we challenge ourselves, because once you get the league, obviously everybody knows how good our league's been. So, you know, going up to Gardner-Webb opening night, a team that was in the NCAA tournament last year and was up 14 on Virginia in the first half, and I think had a 14-game home winning streak going when we went there. You know, we got that opening night win, and that was huge. You know, that was huge for a team, again, that lost those two key seniors, for us to be able to do that out of the gate. And then, you know, we had Loyola in Greenville and played really, really well. And ended up having a 24-point win versus Loyola at home, and you know just played extremely well on both ends of the ball. And you know, we played UT Arlington last week in an unbelievable game. I think they were picked second in the Sun Belt, and we made a play there at the buzzer to get the win. And, you know, it's Elon and the Colonial. You know, played them up there, and then played Alabama and South Florida on the road. So it's also went down to Charleston Southern, who just beat Missouri last night. You know, and played. At Charleston Southern. So we've tested ourselves pretty good on the road. And, you know, to be 7-2 right now, and the two losses to be, you know, versus power, you know, high major opponents. And, you know, obviously it's two games that we would wish we would have been able to win, but we didn't make enough shots and we didn't make enough plays late to be able to get over the hump in those games. But, you know, we gotten a lot better from those experiences, and we got to keep moving forward.
And, Coach, I look at the SoCon standings, Coach. Seven of the 10 schools in SoCon are at 500 or better on December the 4th in non-conference play. For a mid-major league, that is pretty good. If you have seven of your schools over 500, knowing you're going to play bye games, can't really get home games because you might be too good, or you have to go on the road a lot. So, that's, to me, that's amazing for your conference.
Yeah, I mean, the conference has just been really, really good. And, you know, the coaches, the players, the schemes, and, you know, some of the continuity. I mean, it's a really, really good league. And, you know, so that doesn't surprise me at all, just with the quality that our league continues to produce. And, you know, I don't see it slowing up anytime soon. Our league has really made a direct investment in basketball. And, you know, we're trying to continue to push the profile of our league from a basketball standpoint. You can really see it paying off here in the last few years.
Exactly. I know when it comes January here, you know, there's no nights off in that league. You know, even what you might think, is the worst team in the league can still beat you on a given night, because it's a tough game. No matter, there's no easy outs in SoCon nowhere.
Yeah, that really is. I mean, it's you got to be ready to roll. And you know, that's what makes it challenging. It's what makes it fun. It's very competitive. And, you know, when you're on the road, it doesn't matter who you're playing. And really, you know, if you have a bad night at home, somebody can come in there and beat you. So, you know, you gotta really condition yourself to be ready to play every single night and to play to a certain standard, and understanding that it's all about how you play. It's not about who you're playing. It's not about do you win or lose, but, you know, what's the standard to what you're playing at. And for us, there's always a certain way that we try to play. There's a way for us that we feel like in our program gives us the best chance to win. And, you know, we've got to make sure that we try to do that and, you know, try to have the faceless opponent and go try to play to our standard every night and see what happens.
And, Coach, looking at your roster, you have four guys from the Atlanta area on your roster. So, Coach, if you could, give us a little tidbit about each one of those four young men from this area on the roster right now for you guys.
Absolutely. Well, it starts, obviously, with Jordan Lyons is our lone senior. He's only senior on the roster. And, you know, he's our leading scorer right now. And I think he's second all-time in three-point field goals made at Furman. And he's already scored 1,000 points. And it's been a four-year contributor for us here. So, he's been huge. And I think if we hit 20 wins this year, he'll go down as all-time winningest player in Furman history. And so he's been key, great leader, great person, and has been huge for us. We've got Noah Gurley that starts for us as well. That's from, you know, Fayette County. And he's somebody that redshirted, but he was 6'8" and had a 7'2" wingspan out of high school and, you know, wanted to put on some weight in that redshirt year and has really expanded his skill to where he can score really at the block. He can score on the perimeter and just continues to get better. He's only a sophomore for us. And so obviously he's had a huge impact on our program as well and continues to do a lot of good things for us. Jalen Pugh is a shooter. He's a reserve guard for us. He's from Cartersville and he's actually, he might be the best shooter on our roster and really, really can shoot and has really continued to expand some other areas of his game. He's somebody he's just a sophomore. We're trying to work him into some more minutes here into our rotation and adding another guard so we can play, you know, at the tempo we need to. And then we got Marcus Foster, the one I mentioned earlier, that's redshirting. And he's from Drew Charter. He's only 17 years old right now. Doesn't turn 18 until January. So
wow.
He's somebody we wanted to redshirt him. He reported it about 6'4 and a half, 180. And right now, since we got him in June on campus, he's grown an inch and he's put on 20 pounds. So he's redshirted and he's over 6'5" and he's 200 pounds. And he's a great person. He's working really, really hard. He's somebody that's going to have a chance to contribute immediately as a redshirt freshman next year. And Atlanta's been critical to our success recruiting-wise. I mean, it's Daniel Fowler came from Atlanta that's now on our staff. And Stephen Kroon, you know, was SoCon Player of the Year a few years ago. He came from Atlanta. So, you know, that track down 85 has been good to the Paladins. And we want to continue that.
Yes, indeed, because you're not that far away from us, right off the road, in my opinion. So it's a great thing to get guys from the city of Atlanta and the area here. Also, playing at Auburn, you know, that helps as well, because that's still out right down I-85 to Auburn, down through Montgomery there. So, you know, that I-85 corridor is real good. A lot of players. I'm glad that the Paladins definitely tap into that resource and get those guys up there to play for you guys, man.
Absolutely, absolutely. I've recruited that area since I was an assistant at Charleston Southern and continue to do so when I was an assistant here at Furman. And so that's almost home away from home for us. So we want to continue to have a big presence in Atlanta. That's a huge piece of our recruiting.
Coach, best of luck to you tomorrow against Auburn. Hope you get that win for you guys and SoCon gets you another notch in the belt for you guys. Non-conference here against these high major schools, man. Take them down, Coach.
Well, hey, I appreciate you guys having me on. And I'm sure we'll talk to you again here soon.
All right, Coach. Have a good one. Talk to you real soon, buddy.
All right, have a great one.
All right, it's Bob Reed here on the Bossman Show, people.
Hey there. Your yard took a real beating this summer. Luckily, Scott's Turf Builder Winter Guard has your back. Just feed your grass with Scott's again this fall when the air is cool and the soil is warm. It's the perfect time to give your lawn a boost. If you do, Winter Guard will give your yard the nourishment it needs to help weak, thin grass recover and support root growth, giving you a greener, more resilient lawn both now and next spring. Guaranteed. Grab a bag of Scott's Turf Builder Winter Guard today. You'll be back to barbecuing in no time. This is a Scott's Yard.
A gorgeous tan from Suntan City gives you an inner glow that relights the fire when you run into your first crush.
Vicky, who was that?
An old boyfriend.
Lucky you just tanned at Suntan City.
Lucky he's single. We're doing lunch tomorrow.
Won't be single for long then.
During Tour of the City, try all 5 tans, including spray tan, for just $4.99. Restrictions may apply. Click to buy now.